but more of it was from my ability to hear. I heard everything. Doors closing, pages turning, the ceiling, fans circling. In their silent rooms, I heard floor scream, and I heard them laugh. And I wanted to, but it was also heavy on me to know that they knew none of it. It's hard to harness hope when you're in a row of pollution. Even when your good sense says there's no way, hope runs right past reason. I didn't want to accept that there was nothing to be done for these girls. I asked and I looked, and what I learned was the option of cochlear implants. They required surgery. While they did not restore normal hearing, they would allow them profoundly deaf or severely hard of hearing to have some semblance of sound. I didn't search for a segue. Do you know about cochlear implants? I spelled it with my fingers and pointed to where it might be if I had them. Julia smiled and nodded, then pulled back her ear. I asked to see her scar. I pictured how they had prepared the spot, shaved the hair, and then sliced the skin that joined the fur neck and the scalp. The thin round circle was almost hidden in her hair, but the part that looked like a hearing aid was missing. She kept it attached. Why don't you use it? I don't use cochlear because I accept being dead. She was so good to sign slowly for me. I didn't have to ask anymore. She told me how her mother had taken her to get the implant when she was 3. Now that she was older, she could decide what she wanted. Laura stepped in to where we were and motioned us into the kitchen. When we arrived there, I saw Scylla helping 2 of the girls bake cookies. She was kneading the plum brown sugar into a measuring cup. This was the softest I had seen her. The girls eyed her to learn. I jumped like something electric had passed through me. There was nothing in everything, silence to sound in an instant. I thought of that gospel song we talked about the trumpets of the Lord sounding in our time being done for. I snuck a peek at my watch to make sure I was still safe. Laura had put her grandpa's album in the stereo. He was singing "The Voice from On High," and she was helping him. All the girls gathered to feel his voice. They touched the speakers and the countertop to feel the stereo, feeling the vibrations. One girl pressed her ear directly to the speaker. I went to stop her, then remembered it wouldn't hurt. But it hurt me. The music was blaring, the speaker's heat sailed into my ears. It was hot and sharp, making the tender line. They talked over top of the music. Julia stood at the countertop, her elbows resting as she signed, stuttering as she spoke. I felt ashamed there at the music, fat and full on food they couldn't eat. Julia looked at me, her brown eyes like long warm river stones. Can't hear. She pointed to the stereo like she was sipping a solid space between. She only wanted to tell me. I wanted to say I know, let my lips fill those same soft tones my mother had used, try somehow to